Right, well, good afternoon everyone. Welcome to day four of stage three. I'm starting to lose count now. Strategic allocations, airport and Butterfield. First of all, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. That's a good start. Can you make sure your mobiles are on off or silent? I'm sure they're already. And if I can take introductions, starting with the council.
Good afternoon, sir. Wayne Beglin, Council for Luton Borough Council.
David Carter, representing Luton Borough Council.
Kevin Owen, representing Luton Borough Council.
Keith Stiles from Luton Borough Council.
Cameron Hayder from Vectos, representing Henry Boot.
Nick Diamond from GL Hearn, representing Henry Boot.
Adrian Schofield from Henry Boot.
Okay. I guess what I should say is... There are two sites to discuss. I was going to discuss the... I'll take introductions. I was going to discuss the airport first and then Butterfield. I'm hoping those will fall neatly into 50-50, so we have a tea break and then come on to Butterfield. So you're welcome to sit there, but just so you know that, so you can either sit there or you can go away. It's entirely up to you.
OK. Well, welcome for and...
OK, let me carry on.
David Hill, North Hertfordshire District Council.
Tom Southgate, Terence O'Rourke, representing London Luton Airport Operations Limited.
Well, thank you very much. Just before we go on to the discussion, I perhaps just ought to check with the council something about main modifications. So, and it relates to the sessions we've just had on 13 and Power Court and Stockwood. Just to confirm, I said at the start of that session that generally what I've been so far through the examination is, I think, fairly directive in sessions telling you when I think main modifications are needed. But I said before that session started, I would write to you following it. Nevertheless, I did suggest you should keep a record of all the potential main modifications that were discussed. So just to check that you did that.
I've been doing that, sir, yes.
Good. I'm very pleased to hear that. That's good. Subsequently, if I think main modifications might be necessary for anything else, then I would also say that as well.
Yes.
Okay, good. I just wanted to check. That was all clear. Good. I suppose the other thing I should say generally is the discussion this afternoon on both sites, I just intend to follow the order of my matters, issues and questions and just work through them till we reach the end. So, Butterfield representatives, what do you want to do?
If it's all right with you, sir, I'm going to stay in situ as I've got my papers out, but I think my colleagues will probably just sit back and...
That's absolutely fine with me, either way. If you're going, I'll let you go and then I'll... Okay, well, let's turn to the airport then. And my... overarching question was, or issue, were other proposed uses on the allocation appropriate, justified and deliverable, and are the policy requirements sound? And the first question I asked was whether support for the growth and expansion of the airport was appropriate and justified, including as expressed in the strategic objective. Well, I think I understand pretty much the situation from both parties, so I'm content to leave it where you've left it, if you like, unless there's anything particularly you want to say to me.
No, I mean, I think it's covered in the...
Okay. Okay, the second question then was whether the various criteria about airport expansion in criteria B were justified. And... I suppose my I want to leave criteria 3, which relates to the master plan, to my question 3. So this really relates to everything else that's covered in B. I suppose my first question really is, B starts off by saying proposals for development will only be supported where all of the following criteria are met. And I suppose my question is that actually what it means to say on the basis that does every single proposal for development at the airport need to satisfy all 9 criteria? So, for instance, is the policy intended to encompass... I can understand it, that might be appropriate if you're talking about, you know, a major redevelopment or expansion of the airport, but there will presumably could be other forms of development that might take place there.
Yes, sir, that's correct. I suppose the thrust of the policy is about, as you say, significant growth and expansion at the airport, having a relevant set of criteria to judge proposals against them, to monitor the sort of environmental performance of the airport. However, we've seen the representations from the airport and the particular point about, you know, there may be exceptions where you need to distinguish between what's a relevant criteria for a particular development that's happening. So we're prepared to look at the wording there to
okay.
recognise there is, you know, there may be exceptions and some qualifications.
Should the policy perhaps at the start say proposals for development will be supported where, some wording that says where the criteria are relevant given the scale and nature of the proposed development.
That's correct, sir. We're looking at the particular wording that the airport have advanced.
Okay.
We just want to take some specific advice in-house about, so in principle we're accepting that we need to have a look at that wording to change it. It's just being clear exactly what the formal wording would be.
Okay. The airport, is that
the point we've just made is what you alluded to at the beginning of your questioning, in that there could be an application that would be outside the scope of the current approved master plan, but that wouldn't necessarily have a requirement to meet all of those criteria.
Mm.
So I think where, as part of the previous examination process with policy LP1, the council have look to include the sort of wording of where applicable and appropriate to the criteria C to L of that policy. And we have suggested in our written statement that sort of a similar approach would make sense to the specific point.
Okay. So is the broad agreement then that the way to fix it is to say where relevant, having regard to the scale and nature of the development, something like that?
That's correct, sir.
Okay. Criteria 4 says under B4, support for proposals that do not result in a significant increase in air transport movements that would adversely affect the amenities of surrounding occupiers. So I suppose in effect that allows significant increases where it wouldn't adversely affect, phrase the opposite way around. From the airport's perspective, you suggested that ought to be altered to require impacts to be assessed and then mitigated.
Yeah, that's just in accordance with the approach advocated in paragraph 152 of the National Planning Policy Framework, that where it's looking at plan making and looking at the 3 strands of sustainable development. It talks about where significant adverse impacts, they should at first be avoided, and then if identified, and where they're unavoidable, then appropriate mitigation should be forward. So the policy wording was largely accords with what's drafted by the council anyway, but I think we were just looking to sort of tie it in more with the sort of process and the steps advocated in that paragraph.
That kind of clarification is just the detail of the wording that we're still...
Okay, so you agree broadly with, yes, with the contention. I would suggest again that any changes of this nature to a policy really ought to be a main modification. Yeah. Okay, so you'll work together on a draft. Criteria 5 relates to noise reduction and as well as seeking to achieve further noise reduction or no increase in noise, it also, in accordance with any imposed planning condition. And I suppose my first question is, why would a policy in the plan need to require compliance with a planning condition, which in effect development has to... I mean, a planning condition only relates to the specific permission, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And development has to be in accordance with that permission as a whole, including the condition. So I don't really understand how that could have a place in a development plan policy as such.
I think this harks back to the previous policy approach in the existing local plan, where we had reference to the planning application and approved noise contour limits operate at the airport. Again, we've looking at the representations from, or the matter statement from the airport about the planning condition binding their approach to their noise abatement plan. I can't remember the exact terminology now, but we would be prepared to look at that wording as an alternative.
So you agree it's necessary to take out the reference to planning condition?
Yes. Yeah. And sorry, just to clarify about the reference to the point about no increase in air noise. Our wording prefers to have that constraint as opposed to the suggested wording by the airport, which is no significant increase.
This might be semantics, but is there a difference between no increase and no significant increase on the basis that the opposite of significant is insignificant? So you're talking about a very... technically reading the policy, no increase means absolutely no increase, not no significant increase. So should it have that wording in front of it? It's a bit like shouldn't cause harm. Yeah. It can have a little bit of harm.
So can I just have a go at that? That's certainly one way of understanding the word significant. It is used in different ways as well. And so, for example, when inspectors in Section 78 appeals are ascribing the level of weight to give to things, we all, whether we work for developers or local planning authorities, wonder from time to time where significant weight comes, where substantial weight comes, where considerable weight comes, and so on. But significant weight in inspectors' decision letters is typically not used to mean more than insignificant.
Okay.
It's used to mean some appreciable measure on the spectrum. I'd suggest that that's what the word is doing here.
Would an alternative word be material increase?
Again, if one it would be an alternative, but if one thinks about the spectrum, my own take on it, and I'll stand to be corrected by anyone to my right at least, is that significant is probably a higher threshold than material.
So what would you conclude if I was to ask you, should it include the words material increase?
We'd accept that.
Okay, what would the airport say?
I think our use of the term significant increase again relates to the use of that word within the MPPF and how that's assessed in both plan making and decision taking. And I think when you get to the application stage and you have your independent, you have your acoustic consultants sort of undertaking that work, and any sort of environmental report always tends to be assessed in terms of the significance of the impact, as opposed to whether there's an impact full stop. And,
is it possible that a significant impact could be nevertheless an acceptable one? Maybe getting into... Oh, are we getting drawn unduly into semantics here?
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, the airport operator doesn't have any significant issue with... I didn't intend to use it in that... in that way, so...
Sorry, you're content with B5?
Yeah, and if you wanted to use material instead, I think we'd be happy to accept that.
Shall we settle on no material on the basis it provides at least some clarification?
So just to clarify, sir, that was B5 as it appears in the plan?
Yes.
Putting in material?
No material. No, well, it would be no material increase, wouldn't it? Okay, and then when we look at criteria 7, this is to proposals which over time result in a significant diminution and betterment of the effects of aircraft operations on the amenity of local residents. Not sure that's fantastically worded, actually, is it really? But yeah, the airport suggested removing the term significant. Is that something you have strong feelings on?
No, I think we were just looking at... because I think, obviously, there's a number of measures which can, over time, sort of support the aspiration of that section of the policy. So I think that's why we've sort of put in support in the achievement rather than result in. But it's not a point of major contention.
OK. Council? You're happy with the policy as it stands?
I think we're comfortable with the policy as it stands.
Okay. Well, let's leave it as it stands. Okay, so moving on to my question 3. I asked, why is it necessary to acquire expansion is in accordance with the latest planning permission and the airport master plan in criteria B? And my supplementary question isn't the plan the starting point for the determination of any planning applications and the determination of a preparation of a master plan rather than vice versa? In other words, doesn't the plan sit above the planning application rather than the planning application sitting above the plan?
That's correct, sir. And the criteria do allow for the consideration of proposals for expansion above the current permitted planning permission for the airport to 18 million passengers per annum. I suppose the airport have signalled that they're quite comfortable actually with the reference to any further expansion above that being in accordance with a new planning permission and a new master plan. So it's just clarifying that procedurally any growth above the current permission would have to respect, there'd have to be a process of a new master plan and a new planning permission being put in place.
Well, or isn't it, I mean, in that sense, there wouldn't really be any need for criteria B, would there? Because you just have a policy which says you must comply with the existing master plan and planning permission unless you get a new master plan and planning permission. Isn't the idea of B that at some stage during the lifetime of the plan, the airport may want to do some expansion or different expansion, and it would then, parties would turn to the plan to advise them on the issues that would need to be, the criteria that would need to be considered. So I suppose that's my point. Isn't aren't the criteria in B something that would drive a master plan leading to a planning application rather than a criteria that should be met by proposals?
Yeah, I mean, the former, I think, is correct.
In which case?
Airport, we're comfortable with that as setting a kind of a benchmark for the vision for the airport. And
yeah, I think the council have fairly clearly set out their position behind point three in their stage three statement in response to that question. We don't have I think we understand where the council are coming from, don't have a specific issue with that being within the policy. Obviously, whether there's a wider sort of planning test consideration. But
well, let me put it this way. Would it be better if criteria three was deleted and instead supporting text explains that there is a current master plan and planning permission and, you know, any significant expansion beyond that is going to need to meet the criteria set out in Part B. Is that not the way it should really be done in a plan?
I mean, I think the explanation we tried to put in the statement under this question so was sort of predicated on the grounds that airports seem to be sort of treated differently to most of the forms of development by government, in the sense that, you know, a few years back, the government required airports to produce master plans to inform future growth proposals. So I think it was in that sort of context we were talking about master plans rather than sort of ordinary sort of master plans or supplementary planning document
type. But do you see what I mean here, in that the policy says proposals be supported where they are in accordance with the latest permission and master plan. So any proposal that comes in say 5 or 10 years for a different expansion or of the airport will fail to meet that criteria, won't it, inevitably?
I may have misunderstood this, but I think part of the answer may be that the expectation is that the revision to the master plan would predate the submission of the further planning application looking for expansion, and would be subject to a public consultation.
Yeah.
And so that's why it occurs in this slightly odd way. So in general principles, I would agree with your observation. I'm conscious I haven't seen the specific advice that I know the local authority did take about the criteria for this policy. But I think that's the reason why it's in the order that it's in, because the idea is that the master plan will actually inform parameters of the planning application.
Yeah, I think the history is that the master plan would come forward first almost as a sort of vision document for the airport's growth before any planning process. So it might be the use of terminology master plan which is confusing.
I think it may be the wording of this policy that's offending me actually, and the circularity of we will grant proposals for development will be supported if they're in line with the latest planning permission. It just doesn't quite make, that wording just can't make sense to me. It's a bit like saying, we'll allow your house extension as long as it's in accordance with the planning permission that we've granted for your house extension.
Yes, no.
See what I mean?
Yeah. I understand entirely the criticism in relation to the planning permission itself, okay. Which may be separate from the point that I've just tried to explain about the purpose of them.
Should criteria three then just say proposals be supported that are in line with an up-to-date master plan?
Yeah.
We'll stop. Is that the way to do it?
Right. I think that's what we are seeking.
Right, OK. Airport, happy with that? Does that affect what you've described as your minor modification 16? You might just need to look at the wording of that, I think.
Yeah, so we'll revisit that.
Okay. So I'd put the two together probably, yeah. It's a modification. Okay. Okay. My question four then. P6C only permits airport-related car parking outside the allocation where it's demonstrated that there's a long-term need that cannot be met at the airport, and I said that, is that justified? I think I understand from your statements, really, the aim is to keep airport-related parking within the allocation and to encourage access by means other than the car. So I think that is what I understand to be the justification. Yeah. And then presumably the problems with allowing off-site car parking is that it doesn't support that aim of moving the modes away from the car.
That's right. Okay. And the airport also indicated in their statement that there are off-site providers for car parking, and that has impacts on the airport in terms of its infrastructure. So,
In terms of the valet premium, yeah. Valet drop-off services?
Yes, and that sort of loss of control over parking obviously has very significant implications to the surface access strategy that's being implemented to promote sustainable transport modes to and from the airport.
So presumably someone could operate that from an existing car park, couldn't they? But what you're seeking to prevent is new operations setting up. Yeah. Okay. LP6BV, I asked if excessive noise was sufficiently, what was meant by excessive noise was sufficiently clear. Anyone got a view on that?
I think in our statement we've outlined that we don't have a specific issue with the wording of the policy and the use of excessive noise, and I think sort of learning from previous experiences in sort of where things have been very clearly set out in terms of noise parameters, etc., that can very quickly become out of date within a local plan. As technology legislation, etc., changes during that period. So I think the position of the airport is that that would be something that would be considered during an application itself, and it would be appropriate for the acoustic consultant to determine the implications of noise from the development proposals and whether they were deemed excessive.
Okay, thank you. Anything else on that? My question six related to the effect of the allocation, including Century Park, on the character and appearance of the surrounding countryside and landscape and on any heritage assets, and whether those have been adequately taken into account. So from the council's perspective, how will Century Park in particular be integrated, and any adverse impacts on landscape be ensured?
Well, the policy criteria refer to having, due regard to the sensitivity of the landscape in that area with the Shetland's AOB.
We're looking at criteria in part F, aren't we, presumably?
Yeah, just trying. So it's requiring, yeah, part F, I is requiring strategic landscaping. And part two is of F is, you know, obviously looking at the issue of the built form and the height and having regard to that.
Okay, I don't think there's anything specific in the policy about heritage, is there? Historic England, I think, have pointed out that there's the registered park and garden nearby and a scheduled monument. How would they be picked up? I suppose the question is, should there be a criteria in this policy or would it be adequately covered by the generic heritage policy and the plan?
So we consider that it should be picked up by the generic policy in the plan. However, you know, if there is a concern by Historic England that it would help to clarify this particular location is sensitive in terms of the form of development here and its proximity to...
That's probably the approach that's been taken generally elsewhere, isn't it, where these issues have arisen. So perhaps to be consistent, it might need a fourth criteria in F to relate to the effect on heritage assets. Got any comments on that?
No specific objection to the inclusion of an additional criteria, but I mean, when doing a planning application and assessing validation requirements, etc., the requirement to undertake heritage statements and such associated documentation and survey work would be picked up through that process as well. Obviously, if the application was an EIA, there would be a scoping process, which again would look at those. But
okay, so maybe this is belt and braces. Question seven, I asked if the likely effects of the allocation, including Century Park on the strategic road network, were adequately understood, and can those be mitigated? Of course, we've had the general discussion about the impact of the plan overall on the road network. And since we had that discussion, of course, I think we've had the latest position of the Highways Agency that indicates that over the plan lifetime, improvements would be likely to be needed to all three motorway junctions, I think. I think they've said that, haven't they?
Yes, I mean, we certainly said that we would review that, and I think Highways England have produced a note for you, sir, that talked about what was likely to be required.
Yeah. I suppose it could be argued it all becomes immaterial if it's towards the end of the plan period and you're reviewing it before then anyway. So can you tell me what the, you know, what is understood about the potential traffic effects deriving from this policy?
The council's done quite a lot of work in relation to working with Highways England a couple of years ago in terms of looking at capacity in the approaches to the airport. And there's also quite a bit of work that's been done in relation to the transport assessment in the planning application. That work shows that around about sort of 70% of the traffic going to the airport is coming from the junction 10 area of the motorway. The remainder of it is sort of coming around about sort of 4% coming in from the A505 from Hitchin, and the rest of it sort of through the town. So the work we did in relation to Junction 10A takes account of the 18 million passengers per annum. In fact, I think on the Junction 10A work, there's sufficient capacity up to around about sort of 21 mppa. So it would certainly deal with the traffic requirements. There are a number of other junctions that are identified in policy LP31, I think it's B, where there are a number of junctions that have been identified in the transport assessment that require improvement. There will be a sort of a phased approach to those junctions. I'm just trying to find it. It's,
I think if I recall correctly,
it's LP31F, sir.
F, yeah.
So we've got Vauxhall Way, Crawley Green Road, Vauxhall Way, Stocksley Way, Vauxhall Way, Eaton Green Road, Kimpton Road, Vauxhall Way, junctions which we are looking at the moment with the intention of making improvements to those.
Okay. And are those are funded out of the council's own transport programmes, is that right? I think I remember the discussion about it. In some cases, it was just a question of adjusting phasing of traffic lights.
The funding is coming. It is coming from three sources. We've got 2 million of funding, which is a Section 106 contribution from the airport in relation to their planning application. There is 1.2 million from the local growth fund, which is controlled by the local enterprise partnership, and the balance is effectively coming from LBC's integrated transport funding.
Okay, and then presumably some aspects of the policy are in effect designed to, I would suspect, mitigate the effects of traffic through increasing other modes of access to the airport.
There's quite a strong relationship between the growth in airport patronage and the growth in passengers using Luton Airport Parkway Station. There are proposals that the council went to consultation on in the autumn in terms of a mass system between the Parkway Station and the airport terminal. The intention is to submit a planning application in the next few months as far as that is concerned.
Okay,
and that will assist in sort of hopefully taking people off the roads and improving the modal share.
Yeah, and I recall that your overall traffic modelling, you told me that it was worst case in the sense that it didn't include any such mitigation.
Yes.
Can you tell me about access to Century Park, which is indicated by a kind of brownie red arrow, isn't it, and which would therefore, and then it would go across Wigmore Valley Park. And I think I've read somewhere that would replace a more grandiose scheme for some kind of road tunnel, right?
That's correct. The previous scheme ran from the through the airport estate, underneath the taxiway, through a tunnel, which was taken out of the plan because the airport considered it unviable and undeliverable. So in terms of the discussions about alternatives, the arrow is to indicate where the airport considered that there was a feasible option to use the existing road network.
So basically the access is via the existing spine road, isn't it, through
That's
the
right.
airport, and then extending it on through Wigmore Valley Park. What's Wigmore Valley Park like? What sort of effect would it have on it?
Wigmore Valley Park is fairly is a fairly open bit of space. There is a nature conservation interest in the southern sector, as you can see on the policies map. But it is partly also a former spoil heap which has been covered over. So the ground is fairly uneven, so it doesn't lend itself to more formal forms of recreation. It's more informal.
So it's a bit informal, yeah. How would that be affected by having a spine road presumably driven through the middle of it?
There would obviously be an impact in terms of the land take loss, and presumably the effect of on amenity and access to the rest of the park. So the approach in the strategic allocation is to collate both Century Park, Wigmore Valley Park, and the airport estate together, and the policy framework allows for mitigation of the impact of the road as it crosses through the park in terms of replacement provision, like for like, or indeed in of better quality.
That's criteria E3, isn't it?
That's correct.
How does that work in effect? If you say you've got an area of large area of informal open space and you put a road through it, so obviously some land is taken. In practice, how do you replace that with a facility of at least equal quality? I mean,
the intention, sir, is that in remodelling the land budget between Century Park itself, the employment allocation, and Wigmore Valley Park, that the solution would be found through doing compensatory work that way.
Oh, so you might use some of the allocation?
Correct.
Yeah. I mean that would actually be done through a Section 19 certificate, so which is something that we've had previous experience of in dealing with, where effectively, as Mr. Owen says, the area of land required that's taken by the footprint of the road would effectively be provided. As part of the allocation site.
Okay, thank you. Did the airport want to comment on any of those things we've just been discussing?
No specific comments.
Okay. So turning then to Century Park, it's allocated, isn't it, for a mix of B1, B2, B8. I think then, does that make it the only specific allocation for B8 use in the plan? Is that right?
That's correct, sir.
Okay, so how did that come about?
Century Park, as we've put in our master statement, has an existing permission for those uses. It also is a long-standing employment allocation that has run through, this would be the third local plan that it will appear in. And it's always been difficult to deliver the site because of this issue of access, which we've just been discussing, and need to make sure that the access doesn't run along the existing Eaton Green Road. For amenity reasons, and members have been quite clear they want to see an alternative access. So so the B8 element has always been in the frame for
Okay, so is the reason why it's not been delivered down to the... Did the previous plan envisage a tunnel then? Is that...
That's correct.
That's correct, yes. Yeah.
And is that what's rendered the site unviable? Or? Yeah.
Part of the other, so if I may just give a bit more context to the collation of the three elements of the strategic allocation, is that Century Park is pretty much, as well as meeting a general need, is pretty much seen as critical to the future economic role of the airport. And so you know, there is an element of freight aviation that the airport does sustain, and so it's seen as important for that reason.
Okay, well, let's that probably leads on to the second question. I seem to remember we've had this discussion before, haven't we, actually? It's getting a sense of deja vu here. But, and I don't think the airport was present to that. It must have been back at stage two. So the question in question two is, are the first three sentences of LP6D clear and effective? Because the policy states, office, manufacturing, distribution will be supported, including that associated with airport and aviation businesses and industry. But then it also refers to airport and aviation related businesses which can be demonstrated to have a locational requirement, and it's for B1, B2 and 8, all accommodating a significant element of aviation related use. So the question is the intention to limit use of the site to airport related or dependent development, or is it to allow any B1, B2, B8, but particularly? And I think you suggested a modification, didn't you?
That's correct, sir. And in our modification, the first part of the policy D criteria would refer to that generic point about for office manufacturing and distribution.
So, yes, if Mr. Owen pauses for a second, because we've set the new policy out in extenso, as it were, it may be helpful
to just
have that before you. It's page five.
Okay, so yes, far away. Yep. Take me through it.
So the retained the first sentence as far as it's referring to the generic uses of office, manufacturing, and distribution, employment, full stop. And then recognising the point I've made about the synergy with the airport, we're suggesting particular support will be given to provision for those sectors that obviously relate to need to locate there for that reason, for the airport.
Okay, so the
and automotive, sorry.
Yes, okay, so looking at that policy, the first part really says support in principle B1, B2, B8, doesn't it? Yeah. But then it says particular support will be given to B2, in effect, that needs to be near an airport for some reason. But then it's saying that warehousing only must demonstrate a need to be near the airport, so it's not... So that's a restriction on B8, isn't it, in effect?
That is reflecting the aviation... freight-related aviation.
Okay, so that provides clarity over what's intended, whereas I don't think the existing policy has that clarity. Has the airport got any views on that revised suggested wording?
No, other than support was being proposed, and obviously the economic importance of the airport within the region and local supply chain, etc., is outlined within both our stage one and stage three written statements. So just support the council's position on that.
Okay, so that's a main modification that's in effect agreed, isn't it? I think my question three we've probably already discussed, really, because it's about access to the site and can it be developed without significantly adverse effects. And I think I managed to jump ahead and probably discussed my fourth question too, which is about the replacement of open space. And you've dealt with that, I think, as well. And the final question was about the allocation. Policy states allocation includes land within the airport boundary, and I asked if the extent of the strategic allocation was correctly defined on the policies map. I think the only issue I recall about that was actually the other way around, was the question whether from the airport about whether any of the of their land in the Greenbelt ought to come out of the Greenbelt. But I don't think I recall seeing anything that indicates the allocation was wrong at such.
No.
Okay. Right, is there anything else anyone wants to say about the airport of Hertfordshire? You're here. Was there anything you particularly wanted to get across to me?
Not really. We were just really relying on our reps, and it was just okay. Whether anything was going to be raised along the lines of the country
okay.
Park.
Okay. Right, thank you. Well, that takes me through everything I want to cover on that, so thank you. I suggest perhaps we take a break until 3:05 and then come back with Butterfield. see. Okay, right. Butterfield. Again, I've got a sense of deja vu here, because this was covered in terms of the park and ride, and I think to some extent we policy issues were discussed, weren't they, at stage two? So, obviously, you've been away and done some work between you, and just to check, what I have is a statement of common ground dated 20th of December.
Yes, sir.
Which effectively looks like this. It takes the form of a rewritten policy, and in the red text, it's essentially those areas of disagreement, basically, which I think is mostly text from the council that Henry Boot doesn't agree with.
That's right, sir.
Right, good. So, in fact, quite a lot of agreement has been reached from the sound of it.
Yes.
It has, sir. I think, you know... Yeah. I think both parties we've met on, I don't know, probably five or six occasions. Quite a bit of work has...
Right, OK.
Has been...
And that includes on the park and ride, I think, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
You sigh deeply, but yes.
ultimately, yes.
Ultimately. Right, OK. So hopefully this, to some extent, will be a tidying up session. The statement of common ground isn't signed as is traditional, but I think I'm happy to accept that you both agree it in effect. Okay.
I think so. Yeah, just to be, I suppose, to clear, it has been agreed between the parties, and I think really the main outstanding issue probably relates to the park and ride. I think just to be, I suppose, clear from the outset, we, Henry Boot, have... consistently questioned the purpose of the park and ride facility, whether it is to mitigate Butterfield or to serve a wider sustainable borough purpose, and also whether the evidence itself actually, you know, justified that. And I think as we've gone through the sort of the negotiation process, we still question whether the evidence does support the park and ride, and obviously ultimately that's for you to decide. Mm. When you consider the evidence before you. But we have, as I suppose part of the sort of almost drifted into sort of negotiations, as it were, to see, well, what would be required to deliver to meet the council's aspirations? Because you'll see, sir, that there's reference to the idea of a package from the council.
Yeah, so I think we've got to be a little bit careful here. It's just been the first thing... Mr. Dimmitt said, as he opened his observations, is yes, this is a statement of common ground, agreed between both parties. He tells us, and I think it's right, that that's after a series of six meetings where the local authority took up your suggestion with some enthusiasm and energy, as have Henry Boot. And it's the culmination of those meetings that has led to give and take on both sides in relation to this statement of common ground, which has been publicised on the website as being the agreed position between the parties. And that's certainly our understanding as we arrive here today. And so to that extent, whilst there may be some discussion to be had on the penultimate page of this document about precisely the text surrounding the park and ride, the issue of principle is resolved within this document, and it's resolved in the context of give and take on both sides. So one needs to be quite careful about trying to unpick one element of this consensus, because then we'll be talking about other things as well.
I think, if I may, not just to be clear, not for one moment are we suggesting there hasn't been give and take and concessions on both sides. Absolutely. I just merely want to make the point that in terms of the actual park and ride, I would respectfully suggest, sir, that what we may have agreed on that, ultimately, it is for yourself to decide, based upon the evidence before you, whether the evidence for the park and ride is actually robust.
OK, so if I was to brutally summarise your position, is it that you've agreed a position... This redraft isn't it isn't expressed in the form of a main modification, is it? And I'm not quite sure from looking at it how radical a redraft is. It may be...
It was getting too complicated to show it in the normal way.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
So I think what I would... ...up at the end of this discussion, we would then have to interpret it in terms of... Out.
Well, I was just going to suggest if the crossing outs and underlining get to be overly complicated, it may just be more straightforward to cross all of LP7 out and replace it with entirely new text.
Yeah, replaced in its entirety by the following text.
And then perhaps at the main modification stage in your column, you might just indicate where the main changes are.
Yes.
Might be the way to do it. Okay, well, the first, we'll go through my MIQs in order because I think that will allow me to pick up the various aspects in a structured way. So the first question I asked was about use of the site. So we know that in the submission plan, it's allocated for high-quality technology-related B1 uses, and the question is whether that's flexible enough. So I think... You've arrived at position where you both agreed that the scope should be widened to high quality B2. So I think that's agreed. So the issue then becomes the red text, and as the council's desire to limit B1 and B2 uses to applied research and advanced manufacturing, complementing the existing innovation centre and enterprise hub, and contributing to the sub-regionally important technology park concept.
Yes, I mean, I think the name of the policy, sir, is Butterfield Green Technology Park. It's not Butterfield Green Business Park.
Will it be clear what an applied research and advanced manufacturing use is? Would we all recognise an applied research and advanced manufacturing use when we saw it, I suppose, is the question.
I think so. It's talking about this sort of advanced manufacturing, isn't it?
What does advanced mean? High technology? Old technology?
You know it when you see it, doesn't it?
Well, I don't know. That's why I asked the question.
Yeah, and I just think, from a personal perspective, sort of market-facing, I just think it's, completely alien to the market, to the occupier market. And I think by having such restrictive wording in the policy document, you're just basically turning your back on large swathes of potential occupiers that may come to the site.
I think so. This is where we do take issue. We've said all along that we felt the policy was perhaps overly restrictive, not flexible enough. Clearly, through those negotiations with this B1, B2, and B8, but it's, I think, the additional definitions that are trying to be applied. But as you've rightly picked up, this is our concern. We struggle to pinpoint what advanced manufacturing might be. I mean, it could be the introduction of new technologies, it might be improved processes. These are just sort of quick things that, a Google search those up, but it's not, I don't think, an accepted definition. And this is causing some confusion in terms of the commercial.
Can I make a suggestion? Did you want to come back first?
Sir, if I can. Just to row back a little bit, the evidence base on the, in terms of the employment plan review, and the economic strategy of the plan is quite clear about the function and role of Butterfield in terms of helping to diversify the existing manufacturing base of the town, and not forgetting Edenwood investment as well. And that there is an existing presence on the site, which includes the business base, and MTL have moved up there. So there are examples of the type of activity that has you know, applied research and development techniques within it, and you know, the whole point is that with the business base and the campus there as well, that applied research would actually help to you know, achieve that vision and the strategy for the town. And that's always been a long-standing ambition of the authority, and you know, the allocation you know, in the existing plan that's extant at the moment. So it's nothing new in the sense of what we're trying to achieve there.
No, so is it, I mean, is the difference between you about the way it's phrased?
I think from our point of view, sir, as Mr. Owen says, it's nothing new, and it's been around for a while. But I think this is the point. It doesn't actually reflect how, from the commercial point of view, things have moved on. And I think by harking back to that reference, to our minds, it isn't taking account, or it could frustrate us taking account of relevant market conditions, you know, as advocated by the MPPF, and also, you know, the encouragement of securing economic growth.
Can I just... I mean, very quickly, and say that is an observation, as it were, on markets and market forces. What it doesn't do is suggest that, in fact, there is any definitional difficulty with identifying the kinds of uses that would fall within the text that's within the policy. So as long as we're clear, there are two separate points. Henry Boot might say that definitionally this is just so complex that it's switching the market off. You might, on the alternative, say, well, actually, at the moment, with this definition, as in the extant plan, the market isn't coming here. But those are logically separate points, The explanation we've just had tends to indicate that the difficulty isn't actually in identifying what would be compliant with the policy. It's more to do, as far as Henry Boot is concerned, with actually the operation of the market.
I think it's also, if just in response to that, there is also the issue, though, isn't there? As we've said, with things like the Innovation Centre, these are sort of incubator pods. As businesses evolve or scale up, there is then a danger that they maybe do not fit neatly within this definition.
Okay, can I make a suggestion? How would you both feel if the policy, instead of trying to define what high quality is such by reference to a particular kind of manufacturing. And I have to say, I'm not entirely sure I would know what an advanced manufacturing use was such. But what if the policy said something like high quality B1 and B2, which is compatible with and consistent with the technology park concept, with supporting text that expands on that by reference to the existing Innovation Centre and Enterprise Hub, and by making it clear that development that compromised the concept wouldn't be supported.
So, can I just make the point that part of the policy is all, you know, in terms of, we had a similar issue with the airport policy, and that we're actually trying to signal what the raison d'etre of this facility is, in addition to the actual title of the policy. And it's very important that we give that message out to the market consistently. However, you know, in terms of the negotiation and the discussion that's gone on in terms of revisions to the policy, we do see that we are accepting that there are market signals to suggest that does need to be some give and some flexibility about other uses. So, you know, we don't see that as a, you know, this wording is a deterrent in any way. It's actually sending the positive message about what this facility should be.
Yeah, I think it's more my concern about knowing what advanced manufacturing, applied research and advanced manufacturing is, and I suppose that's why I'm suggesting something that leaves in effect, something which is consistent with and complements the technology park concept, but without actually using the words applied research and advanced manufacturing.
Yeah, we think that's fine. We can.
I think so. where we struggle slightly is to understand, perhaps, you know, trying to find, again, it's another definition of what a technology park is. I think on the one hand, if it's the way, the look, the feel of the park as it's laid out at the moment, I think, you know, those areas are safeguarded by other parts of the policy, such as the height, the density, et cetera, et cetera. I suppose it's trying to understand what a technology park actually is.
I'm going to come in again there, because we have our wonderful statement of common ground, and within the Henry Boot version of the language that we're discussing at the moment, there's no suggestion of a change to the title. So technology park, one assumes we know what we're talking about in broad terms. And then towards the end of that paragraph, so perhaps picking up on some of the language that you have suggested, that are consistent with the technology park concept. Again, your words perhaps go slightly beyond that in terms of strength, but the idea is the same.
I think what I'm going to put to you is that paragraph with the red text, perhaps what it really should say is supports high-quality B1 and B2 uses or development which are compatible with and consistent with a technology park concept. I'm not sure we're ever going to be able to realistically get much further than that. And then that might possibly need some supporting text. But I'm not quite clear what that would say necessarily beyond. I suppose it could refer to the concept of a technology park, including the existing innovation centre and enterprise hub. So that would be a factual statement about what the technology park is at the moment, wouldn't it? Party's moderately content with that.
Yeah. Well, I've got a view, but
okay.
I struggle with the whole thing, really, quite frankly. It's just...
Right. B8 uses, I think, accepted by both, limited to two particular plots. The only difference then between you is the council's desire to limit it to developments that serve the local functional economic market area. I suppose my question is, what does that mean in practice? What's a B8 use serving the local functional economic area?
I think, what we were referring to there is that there are quite a lot of sites in the M1 corridor located much more closely to the M1 and are sort of probably sites that can accommodate large strategic B8 type warehousing, which can actually be quite high these days as well. And the point we were really making is that we didn't think the location of Butterfield was really comparable to those sorts of alternatives that exist elsewhere. But equally, a smaller scale warehousing developments, which would be height restricted in accordance with the policy quite substantially, they would be more likely to be sort of serving the very more local area rather than national markets.
Yeah, so you're wanting to avoid a major supermarket distribution depot, aren't
yes.
you, with something of
yeah,
that
that's
nature.
Right.
So it's an attempt to control the scale and extent of activity, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
Is it going to be clear what the local functional economic area is? To anyone?
Yeah, I mean, that's a reference to the FEMA study, sir, which the work kind of builds on, you know, defining a geography which is, it looks at some of the same indicators or similar indicators that would define the housing market area, for instance. So it's a kind of sub-regional geography that would have Luton within it and how it overlaps with...
Do you not end up with something fairly large scale serving... it's quite a large area, isn't it?
It isn't. The workshop in February last year where the criteria were looked at and various options for defining the area suggested that there was quite a similar
geography, but skewed perhaps a bit further north, maybe further northeast, including the Luton conurbation, similar to the housing market area.
Mm. I suppose my point is that not quite a large area, and you might find serving an area like that something quite significant in size.
I mean, this was to be used as a way of conveying the sub-regional element of, you know, what this site would serve in terms of NEBA. But there are other criteria in the policy that would restrict the...
Yes, sir, such as the height and the restriction to certain plot areas as well. Mm-hmm. So I think physically it would be probably quite difficult. Really massive warehousing facility there.
Given the technology park concept, how come you accepted BA use?
Well, this was part of the package.
and to be fair, it is a limited, it's a constrained acceptance that maybe BA should be part of the mix, but in a way that would work, that it would screen and cluster the uses in a way that it didn't conflict with the existing presence that's on there already, and the remainder of the site that would come forward for the rest of the technology park.
Have you seen a plan, sir? I know that there was a plan doing the rounds, and I'm suddenly now wondering whether you've actually seen it showing which areas would be acceptable.
No, I mean, I think there's a written description, isn't there, somewhere of probably in the statements of which plot, but I don't think I've seen a plan. If you want to table one, I'm happy to look at it.
I do have one here. I think it's been scribbled on slightly, but it... I only have the one, unfortunately. But maybe if we can just pass it to the council, just check the council agree that that's the...
I suppose my question to Henry Boot is that B8 perhaps seems to be something of a concession, and it wasn't in the original, it's not in the submitted policy, is it? So it's a widening from B1 to B2, B8. Do you accept the council's argument that there has to be some constraint over B8 to fit with the technology park concept? And I suppose your concern is partly about using the site up for B8 uses when really you'd seen this as being supporting your economic needs assessment.
I think from our point of view, sir, we obviously, you know, we would like as much flexibility as possible, but we understand that that isn't possible in this instance. We are aware, though, that within the new draft, for want of a better word, there are, various elements to that policy which require the way that the site will actually look, the feel of it, the landscaping, the height, et cetera, et cetera. So I think all of those things, dare I say it, if you were to enter the park, if all of those criteria were met, other than actually, if you to go inside, you wouldn't know whether it was a B8 unit or a B1 or a B2, because they would be maintaining that tone of the park. Okay. I think the area that we've agreed that the B8 can go, obviously, is a contained area and is a screened area. And obviously, a number of the units, on the park have or will have elements of B8. This is the solely B8 area of the park.
So, why would you not accept the restriction that it's B8 users serving the local area, however that's...
I think it's just a again, it's a bit like the conversation we had 5 minutes ago, you're restricting them. So if a company came along and wanted 25,000 square feet and he provided widgets to Europe, then you'd say, no, he can't come, which is just a nonsense. And, you know, as my colleague here said, you know, there's sufficient control in the other elements of the policy to actually frustrate, you know, any sort of large distribution style, you know, major distribution type facility, which you see up and down the M1 coming to this site.
An example, sir, of a possible development that cropped up that wouldn't be permitted under the existing sort of policy was in relation to a possible relocation of a window door frame manufacturer from Hightown. That obviously involves manufacturing, but also quite a lot of storage, that type of facility. So I think that's sort of an example of a local business and serving the local sort of area that, you know, obviously might be relocated because of housing pressures elsewhere. Mm. That's something that cropped up, I think, on this site.
But is it not the case then you might have under this, under your policy wording, a fairly small scale BA use distributing not that much in volume, but not to Luton, whereas then you might accept under this area something quite large distributing window frames to the area, to put it like that?
I don't think that would be especially large, so a factory like that, or a facility of that sort.
No, it's probably unfair of me to give particular examples, but I have in mind, you know, I came across once, it was a B1 use that developed pharmaceuticals, and the site was a mixed B1, B8 use because they developed pharmaceuticals, commissioned those from somewhere else, made them, and then they were distributed from the site. So it was mixed B1, B8 use, but the B8 use was quite small scale in the sense that the product going out wasn't very big.
I think that the way we've tried to express this policy is that we're only talking here about B8 only uses being especially sort of restricted. If it involves the manufacturing element as well, then clearly there may be an element of storage as part of a manufacturing.
I'm just trying to give, I appreciate we're talking about planning policy here, but I'm talking real issues here. You know, we've got a company who, you know, who stores, he wants to come to the site and he stores, it's like an ACO drain detail in there, but they're a German company and they want to come there, they want a 15,000 square foot unit and they want to distribute from there across the whole of the UK. And as this wording stands at the moment, it would be a red card event. It couldn't come.
I suppose the question is, how would you control, in effect, where a B8 use distributes to?
Description of development or condition.
Mm. I'm struggling to see an easy way through this one.
Yeah.
But, the other thing that's missing from this is that the wording for the B1 and B2 refers to high quality, whereas the draft here doesn't refer to high quality B8 development, doesn't it? Does it? Is that in any way significant?
Well, I think that may need to be clarified, but I think that the principle is the high quality of design that we would be looking for in terms of the whole site would apply equally to the B8 as it would to the B1 and B2.
What about something like this? High quality B8 use, which is compatible with the technology park concept. And where the B8 use is relatively small scale in nature and operation, something like that.
My initial comment there, sir, is that just thinking sort of the bigger picture and the aspirations, you know, for economic growth and for the park to, you know, to develop. Whilst unappreciated is with the B1 and B2, there is this recognition of, you know, inward investment, expansion and relocation. That does prevent potentially any of those issues happening with a B8, which may evolve over time.
What? Sorry, the wording I read, outward.
Yes. I think that part, the final part, I think I didn't actually jot down the exact wording, but I think we're saying small scale in nature or worse to that effect. It would prevent any expansion there. I appreciate that there's a spectrum and no one is looking at a huge sort of multinational Google distribution centre there.
Okay, what about something like high quality B8 use where the scale and nature of the use is compatible with the technology park concept?
Just one perhaps caveat to that would be the scale needs to relate to the restriction that we're placing in terms of the footprint of the B8 as well, because apart from the, you know, maintaining the rest of the concept of the technology park, there is the concern that we have about the massing in the height of the B8.
Is that not
impact on the?
It's scale and mass a design issue that would be controlled under other aspects of the policy.
But also the form of the development in the site is pretty much what we are suggesting is the foot plate for the B8 is pretty much in the centre of the site, within natural features of the head, the kind of arc of hedgerows that would contain it, which would help to then maintain the remainder of the site for the technology park, where it gets closer to the site boundary, which would then have the consideration of the AOMB, because it's a sensitive area of the AOMB, in proximity. So hence, you know, the footprint of the B8 needs to be tightly constrained to the core area, apart from the one extra.
Yeah, I'm not suggesting suggesting amending the sites that it would go on, or we'll come on to the plot ratio policy in a moment. It's just specifically
it's the first clause of
yeah.
What we're concerned with.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's the concern.
Yeah, sorry, we've not gone past B yet. Yeah.
I would suggest, though, that the point 8, you know, that picks up the restricting of the heights across the site, doesn't it? And talks about, you know, basically if anything wants to vary from that, it needs to be demonstrated that there will be no impact.
Well, and you've got the plot ratio. So let me ask the question again. If the B8 section was worded, so this would be Part B, high quality B8 use where the scale and nature of the use is compatible with the technology park concept. So that doesn't provide a restriction on where it delivers to, but it would give some indication that it's avoiding major retailers' distribution depot. Any comments?
I think in terms of that wording, I think, as you say, if the scale by implication is relating to the density and to the height, as you say, it ties in with the compatibility for the technology park. My only point, and again, I don't want to be seen to be sort of going back and unpicking, but there hasn't been, as far as I'm aware, any suggestion to date in terms of limiting the size of the B8. I just want to make sure that isn't now being suggested. I don't think it is within that word.
I suppose when I was... Yes, this is where phrasing matters, doesn't it? I suppose when I was thinking of scale, I was thinking maybe about the intensity or the number of vehicle movements, the amount of HGV traffic, for instance. So I wonder if it's about scale, intensity and nature of the use.
I mean,
mean, my experience of the warehousing sites is that the warehouses are probably the equivalent of 7 or 8 stories high. A lot of these big ones.
Mm. Well, yeah. I mean, I think market forces would dictate anyway. You're never going to get a distribution unit of that size in this location because their location criteria is always they need to be sort of, you know, 2 minutes from a main motorway junction. So you're never going to get a 500,000 square foot Google distribution unit here.
Just on that point on vehicle trips, I mean, overall the B8 will have less vehicle, should have less vehicle trips compared to B1 and B2, just because the number of staff movements, number of visitor movements should be significantly less. There will be more HGV movements, but overall the number of vehicle movements should be less for B8.
I'm not sure about that. I mean, I wouldn't be quite so sure about that. Even if there are less movements, they may be HGVs rather than lighter vehicles in lots of cases.
But overall, the number of trips will be significantly less. I mean, that's borne out through sort of TRIX database and lots of research in terms of trip rates per 100 square metres for different uses, B1, B2, B8. B8 significantly less.
Again, I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, but I think speaking for those on this side of the room, your latest formulation, as it were, we think meets the essential issue that we want to try and meet with this policy.
Okay. Could you live with that?
I just have a real general problem with why we're trying to restrict down what we're doing down there, you know. The site has been hardly a rip-roaring success over the last 10, 15 years. There's actually been zero development down there for 5 or 6 years, and one of the specific reasons why there's been no development down there is that the planning policy is too tight. And, you know, I'm moving the agency community nationally, and without a shadow of doubt, if you ask 50 people active in the market, bringing occupiers to business parks, technology park, the one main reason why we have not got that park filled is this specific sort of picky policies that, you know, have been talked about today, and I don't understand why we want to do that, because the council as a whole are very pro-economic regeneration, and really, you know, what we're talking about today is just a recipe to switch the market off completely.
They're not quite a significant change, though, from the policy that's drafted in the submission plan, which is solely B1 uses, to now widened out to B2 and some B8. So there is a move there, isn't there, from the council?
I mean, one thing I'd like to add, sir, is that the representation did not even request B8. It's the flexibility of B8 that's come out in the meetings, and this is where we've tried to be flexible.
I think, actually, to be fair, and I can double-check, it did come up in... It has been raised in one of our representations that there should be flexibility for B1, B2, B8. But actually, as you say, the focus of B8 has been of the last... 6 months or so in those discussions, because the market has changed. We have had to respond. I think this is the point. We first started looking at this back in 2014 from a planning position. And over that time, the demand has changed for the site.
Okay.
I'll just come back to make a kind of general point about, you know, the market. The market can be quite volatile, and obviously... we have actually got a presence on the site, which is in keeping with the technology park concept. And while there may well have been a hiatus with the economic cycle, there is evidence that we explored during Matter 2 on the economic outlook for Luton, and the evidence submitted by agents, which indicated that there was now a significant rising demand for smaller types of industrial occupiers, which may well need to look at such a site as that Butterfield. So, you know, the point we're making is that we think we've got the flexibility there to actually address.
Okay, I mean, I'm going to have to reach a conclusion on this. I don't quite go along with the local functional economic market area, so I think I'm going to suggest to you the wording that I... which you've said you've agreed to. Do you need me to read that again, or are you...
I think I've got it, sir.
It was high-quality B8 use where the scale and nature of the use is compatible with the technology park concept. I suppose the point is these will be advertised as main modifications, so you'll get a second, yes, you'll get a second go at arguing about them, should you wish. Okay, let's move on.
Sorry, sir, just 5 seconds before we do. I think in one of your formulations you said scale, intensity and nature of the use, and I think that's the one that I was giving express assent to, but there may not be much difference.
Well, intensities may be a subset of nature. Depends how you look at it.
Yeah. My preference, if it is so, it would be with scale and nature.
Okay. Shall I leave that with you to consider?
Thank you.
The policy in D now introduces some totally new uses, doesn't it? Small-scale retail, A1 and A3, and leisure uses such as a gym. So why is the policy unsound if they're not introduced? Is that an attempt to, again?
That's not in disagreement, sir.
No, it's not in disagreement. I suppose looking at where I'm really supposed to be coming from, is the policy sound as it is? If it's not, how is it made sound? So I suppose the question I should be asking really is, why does the policy need to introduce A1 and A3 and a gym use in order to be made sound?
May I just come in that if we consider the type, if you look at, say, Butterfield Green, which is the very successful business park, that has an element of A1 and D2 and A3, which relates to serving the workers who occupy the site. So this
suggesting
really
a gym on the site would primarily be used by people who work on the site, rather.
Well, I mean, it would be more than just who work there, but there is an example that, you know, in terms of trying to sustain and make these business parks or technology parks work, that some degree of opportunity for workers to actually undertake, you know, get something to eat or to go and get some exercise is not really incompatible with the, if it's small scale and limited.
Presumably you'd agree with that.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to take issue with that. We'll come on to park and ride in a little while. My question two was, has the effect on the character and appearance of surrounding countryside and landscape been taken into account, and will any adverse effects be mitigated? I think I understand where you're coming from, and I think part of the argument is that the policy criteria are about controlling the effect of developments. Haven't really got any further questions on that. Question three asked was, given the site's partially developed, is there a robust justification for a master plan? I think you agreed between you to use the wording an indicative master plan rather than a comprehensive master plan. You'd like to tell me what the difference is?
I think the discussions with Henry Boot, they were concerned that at the potential cost and perhaps the inflexibility of having a master plan that covered every single facet. So we wanted to look at what would the master plan try to achieve in terms of reconciling some of the key issues about development of the site. So that's what indicative is meaning, is it's a slightly higher level of getting some broad principles shaping the form of the site overall, and then giving the context for individual planning applications and individual plots to address those without having to.
Okay, and presumably the revised policy as it stands is to some extent quite directive over what happens on parts of the site, isn't it?
Yes, it
Anything you want to comment on that?
No, nothing to add to that, sir.
Okay, well, again, I'm not going to quibble with that change. Okay, my question four then was about footprint, density and height, and I think you've reached agreement again, but with one exception. So if I understand this correctly, the council wants the footprint of buildings to be no more than 35% of the gross plot area of the site overall. So really you're looking at the overall site and saying that buildings shouldn't be more than 30%. Whereas Henry Boot just wanted to be the gross area of Butterfield. So what's the difference between gross and plot in reality?
So I think the Henry Boot suggestion is that the restriction of the percentage should be apply across the whole of the Butterfield allocation, whereas the council's view is that the percentage restriction should apply to each plot comes forward with a planning permission.
So under your suggestion, you might get 40% on one site compensated by 30% on another site, for instance.
Yes, sir. But also, I think the other part to that is when you actually look at what has been developed on the site on individual plots at the moment, it exceeds 35%. So I think our starting point was we didn't understand why there should be a density restriction which clearly hasn't been applied. In the first instance, for each individual plot. I think so, if it helps, I think some of the units are somewhere maybe 40 and 45%.
So, I mean, just to come back on that, I think the percentage that is being referred to is in regards to the MTL building.
Yeah. Which one's that?
That's the block that would appear on the sort of north of your plan there.
Once marked Eaton Power.
That's it.
Mm. Okay. So do these other three developments, are they all less than 35%? The village, the innovation centre and the hotel?
I can't be sure about that without checking back, but the point I was going to make is that while the policy is there, we've always said to Henry Boot that it's always down for particular circumstances to be demonstrated where you might marginally exceed or have a case for relaxing the policy to a certain extent. And that obviously must have been the case with MTL for whatever the reasons were when they granted.
I mean, is there another way of wording the policy, which would be for the policy to set the principle and the supporting text to include some guidance, so that the policy might say development proposals must achieve a sense of a density that achieves a sense of spaciousness that reflects the technology park concept, and then supporting text explains that, generally speaking, that will be achieved by limiting density to less than 35%. Unless, and then the precise percentage achieved will be determined by the suitability of individual scheme design, taking into account landscaping and layout. Would something like that do the same job?
Yeah, it sounds okay to me.
So in other words, the policy sets the concept.
Yeah.
The supporting text gives a bit more indication of that, but it remains a bit more flexible about how it would work rather than setting a precise percentage figure that must always be adhered to. Any comment?
I suppose, respectfully, I don't see there's necessarily anything wrong with the suggested policy as it is, save for the disagreement in the figure. But I think importantly with the figure, though, it just seems, whilst we welcome the council's flexible approach on that, to be suggesting a figure, which isn't being applied on the ground. Seems slightly counterintuitive.
I think the MTL building's 55%.
Well, subject to, you know, what the other developments on the site have achieved as well. But
would that not then your argument logically lead to a policy which says proposals must achieve a sense of spaciousness that reflects the technology park concept and supporting text that indicates what a percentage might be, but the precise percentage will be determined by the design and layout and landscaping of individual proposals?
I think we're looking sceptical.
I think at that stage we probably are losing the level of certainty that we would get from the supporting text, where we have a normal rule, which would be the expectation informing how the policy is likely to be applied. Whilst your last formulation undoubtedly is more flexible, it then really would be under subjective decision making on each application that came forward, and it would would tend to undermine the overall approach of trying to respect the technology park.
Well, in which case, instead of having that text in the supporting text, could it say, number one, policy, achieve a sense of spaciousness reflecting the technology park concept? For this reason, the aim is that buildings should generally not occupy significantly more than 35% of the plot area, or around 35% of the plot area, but the precise percentage achieved will be determined by individual scheme design, taking into account quality, layout, landscaping. So if you like, you've got a figure, but you've got flexibility around that depending on how it works on the site.
So the risk of stepping on Mr. Owen's shoes, by and large, for my own part, I would think that's that works, but perhaps just before the 35%, it should be not normally occupy more than 35% of the plot area, but then precise, depending on the various further factors that you mentioned.
Okay.
I think so. Yeah, the principle, I sound like a broken record, and I appreciate, I can't say exactly the density of all of the other units, but my recollection is that they are above 35%. I just
35% derived from the existing plan?
It's actually 30% in the...
30%, right, okay, so...
And I'm not quite sure, though, where that's come from. No. I appreciate it's in the plan, but what the justification for that is.
The justification is because the development in principle at Butterfield, when it was first mooted and put into the local plan and application made, generated a significant amount of community and member concern because of the sensitive nature of that site on the doorstep of the Chilterns AONB. So it's quite clearly a key matter that's relevant to restrict development at that location. But it doesn't just relate to landscaping, it's relating to the visual impact of development in an open plateau in relation to the Chilterns AOMB.
But I would...
Okay, so it's moved from 30% in the submission draft to 35. And what is it in the current local plan? Is there a simple 30, so...
But it doesn't respectfully so reflect what's happening on the ground. I understand that...
We accept that there may be particular circumstances that mitigate against a slightly increased percentage. But, you know... there's quite clearly a rationale behind it, which is a concern about the impact on the Chilterns AOMB. The council regards this very seriously, that this should be part of the policy.
Okay, well, I think I'm going to suggest something along the lines that I came up with there, really. Do you want me to read it out again?
Would you want to?
Well, I don't know if I've necessarily got the wording quite right, but... proposals must achieve a sense of spaciousness that reflects the technology park concept. First point. So then, however worded...
So I think you have, for this reason, buildings
Yeah, the aim, buildings should generally not occupy significantly more than 35% of the plot.
Sorry, so was that 30 or 35?
35. Yeah, sorry, I wasn't intending to change that from where you'd reached agreement. I'd be loath to do that. But the precise percentage achieved will be determined by the design of the development, including layout and landscaping. Maybe even height. I suppose any of those things that might affect a perception of spaciousness.
Yeah. And the visual impact.
So can you just read that last bit again, please?
I was kind of making it up on the hoof, really.
Precise percentage achieved will be determined
by the quality of the design, taking into account landscaping, layout, height.
And views.
The use is
the A. The A and B is the critical kind of... constraint on generating the need for this element of policy.
Well, is perception of density determined by a use? Because you can have a building that looks the same, couldn't you, occupied by a B1, B2 or B8 user that's substantially the same in its mass and its footprint on the site. Is this policy? This policy is really about spaciousness, isn't it? Gaps between building, what the place feels like, design. Is that not what it's getting at?
But also, the views into the site and also mainly into the site from within.
You've got that anyway under V111, haven't you?
Okay.
Well, the ones that strike me are landscaping, layout. Maybe it's positioning of buildings. Shall I leave you to look at the detail wording? Is there any other observations you want to offer on that?
No, I think so. Keen to sort of keep it as tight as possible.
So we're obviously going to go away and look at the drafting. So thank you very much for those helpful indications. The only other point I had was in relation to the should normally occupy more than 35% of the plot area, subject to those precise characteristics. But I think you may have suggested significantly more than the 35%. The only concern I'd have with that is that then you start having a debate about what is significantly more than 35% rather than just leaving it as a 35%. But if we go away and come up with a draft...
I think we also, of course, the indicative master plan starts to show also the relationship between the buildings and where the landscaping, etc., might be.
It could do, but would that not change quite significantly depending on what users come forward on individual plots? Because you might show some indicative massing on a particular plot, but that could potentially change, could it not? Depending on
the massing might change. I'm just thinking more though the landscaping and those sorts of issues.
Yeah,
and how. How sort of plots are generically treated, shall we say, with sort of landscaping or car parking or those sorts of issues.
Okay. And I suppose, is it not the case this policy would be have to look, if in terms of development proposals would be looked at in the round anyway, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Right, next one, height, part 8. So the permitted plan is two stories or three stories where use can be made of roof space, and the revised wording says two stories or three stories where it wouldn't have an impact on views into the site. So that seems to be agreed. Okay, I'm not going to disagree with that. My question 5 was about, is it feasible to retain all existing landscape features, hedgerows, ponds, and all safe existing rights of way? I think, again, you've got a form of wording there you've agreed, haven't you?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
which is basically to safeguard unless it's not practicable, in which case they'll be safeguarded or redirected as necessary in 9. Okay, so again, I'm not going to disagree with that. Right, deep breath. This takes us to the park and ride site. So where we left it last time was for the two parties to go away and discuss it, both in terms of need and then in terms of what the policy was actually seeking, because I think my view was that the policy was rather ambiguous about what it was actually requiring.
The triggers, I think.
Sorry?
Triggers, need for...
Yeah, well, triggers, and whether it was actually even required at all or merely supported. Since then, you've made your park and ride report available from 2016, and I've seen your statement on it. So if I go through what I... just perhaps disregarding that discussion we had early on. Looking at this cold, I think what you've agreed at is safeguarding land for 450 spaces. Yeah. Near the innovation centre. So that's the innovation centre, isn't it, down there? So yes. So we're looking at that site in effect.
No, it's actually, so I think the area in
the area north of the hotel, which is the V shape.
Ah, right, okay. So, yeah, it depends on what you mean by near, I suppose. Okay. So, but anyway, near the innovation centre. So you're really talking about somewhere close to the front end of the site, aren't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Subject to, though, sir, sorry, at the end of the statement of common ground, where you see there is an asterisk. It may go somewhere else. There is a question, dare I say, that in bringing forward the technology park, where the park and ride is proposed, is a commercially very attractive site, which would sort of complete almost a sort of a boulevard.
Yeah. Further. Okay. And then the draft says that's to mitigate traffic in the borough and promote sustainable trips to and from the development. And I think that's part of the quid pro quo, isn't it? Then there's agreement on transferring the site when... that's not agreed, actually, is it? There's when a specific percentage of the remaining undeveloped land area is developed. But in any case, regardless of what the percentage is, does that need a start date?
Well, we're suggesting by the end of 2020.
No, I mean, I meant 50% of remaining undeveloped land. Is there not going to be... What's the base date for remaining undeveloped land as of January 2017? Do you see what I mean?
Yes.
You know, if something's built tomorrow, what was
25
or 50% of what? Okay, the land then safeguarded for 5 years, that's agreed, I think. And if it's not built out stroke operational, it will transfer back. Does built out stroke operational mean the same thing?
Yes.
So in other words, once it's been built, once it's been set up as a park and ride site.
Yeah.
Okay. And on the basis of the policy, the council won't seek any further Section 106 contributions for transport. So that's part of the negotiation. Okay, so all of that's agreed, and does that provide... I'll come on to the things that are not agreed in a moment. So does that provide clarity and deliverability which was where my concern was about, partly.
Well, that's the key point that we tried to address in the wording.
Okay. Right, so shall we look at what's not agreed? So the first is the timing of the land transfer. So what the council want is by the end of 2020 or when 25% is built out. Did I read somewhere that Henry Boot's seeking 50%?
Yes.
So simply 50%?
Yes. The rationale there from Henry Boot's position is that land isn't owned by Henry Boot and would have to be purchased and drawn down. So any sort of trigger date has implications for that. That's an additional cost which is required. And, you know, if you're only talking 25%, there isn't necessarily very much development having taken place on the site.
Right, so you don't control that, the land that might be used for park and ride?
We have to draw it down from the landowners.
Is that because the site, I seem to recall, the site's owned by three parties?
Correct.
Right, yeah, okay. And so is that the reason why you don't like the 2020 on the basis it's 4 years away?
Correct.
Council's perspective?
From our perspective, sir, we're keen to try and achieve more sustainable means of transport within a reasonable timescale, and that's why we put in the end of 2020, which I think we would regard as actually more useful and more important than the actual percentage, because the policy could actually say by the end of 2020 or when 50% potentially, but it's having reasonable certainty that this proposal can be delivered within a reasonable timescale. With a percentage only, it seems rather open-ended.
It's probably also worth adding to that. I mentioned earlier on that the council are intending to improve some of the various junctions that are identified in LP31 in relation to the airport, and some of those junctions are also the same junctions where the park and ride would actually pass through. Our current programme of work is to deal with the improvements to those junctions in 2020. So ideally, we'd want to put in the necessary measures at those junctions to incorporate the park and ride at that same time, rather than go back and have to revisit them later on.
Okay, how long is it likely, do you estimate, for 25 or 50% of the site to be developed out?
Well, it depends how loose the planning framework is. I mean, there's been no development down there for, I think, 5-6 years. So obviously we have a concern that, you know, if we get tied into a date, you know, it could well come to pass that we were unsuccessful in attracting any other occupiers to the site. So it seems logical to my mind for us to commit to, you know, a large capital sum to draw down land from landowners if we don't have any certainty that we've got any, you know, profit coming out of the site.
So your worry is that by the end of 2020 nothing may have happened?
Correct.
And therefore it will be a cost to you?
Correct.
Acquiring that site? Well, it's quite difficult from getting drawn into some quite difficult, detailed. You're leaving me to resolve all these tricky issues, aren't you? Okay, you might say that's what I'm supposed to do.
percent of the site of remaining site development area is quite a lot of development.
2020 is in effect 4 years away, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you're saying you doubt whether you might have the capital to secure.
Well, I'm just saying that, you know, you look at the history of the site, you know, there's been no development down there for 5 or 6 years, zero, and the previous amount of development on the site took probably in excess of 10 years.
Okay. Is there a compromise here where the 25% stays, but the council flexes on the 2020 date?
Yeah, I mean, one point that we could make is that the other changes that we're making or proposing to make to this policy actually make the animal, as it were, that can be marketed and hopefully developed completely different to the context which you're... you're saying. I mean, that's the whole objective, isn't it? Compared to the adopted policy. I mean, another alternative to try and move things on, so would be if we were to sort of say, well, rather than specifying 2020. Move that on to 2021, 2022, and keep the 25%, say.
Okay, how would you feel about that as a compromise, 21 or 22, along with 25%?
I really don't want any time scale on it, because if there's no development, why would we? You know, why would we? You know, it's we're making a financial commitment when we have no certainty as to whether we're going to get any space away on the site.
And some of the other background to this, sir, is that the requirement for park and ride as part of this development site has been there for some considerable time from the extant local plan. So it's not a surprise.
I understand that. Well, is the alternative then to leave it as a percentage, but just go with the council's percentage, 25%? Yeah. Because I can understand your concerns about a date. You know, so the date rolls past and there's been no development, leaving with a capital cost. But on the other hand, if there is, but I can also understand the council's perspective that they want to see this delivered. So is the alternative just to go with the 25% of the remaining site developed?
So I was just going to say that, particularly with the date, if we're talking about no development, there's no traffic to mitigate from Butterfield. One of the points being made is that park and ride is required to mitigate traffic. We would argue that it's not required to mitigate any of the traffic, but certainly if there's no development, there's no traffic associated with that.
Okay, so how would you feel about a proposal that was just transfer when 25% has been developed?
I would still prefer a higher percentage figure. I mean, there is still significant amounts of money that needs to be invested in this site in terms of utilities. You know, so you know, if I had a pot of money to facilitate this development, yeah. I would prefer to be spending that money on, you know, upgrading, you know, spending £4 million updating electrical supply.
So for you in principle, a percentage-based figure would be more palatable because it relates to what you're delivering.
Correct.
But you think 25% is too low. So from the council, could you live with, on the basis that Henry Boot got concerned that if they don't secure any development funding, park and ride is difficult, and the argument that there won't have been any traffic generated from development to help justify it, so therefore a percentage is better than a date, would you be comfortable with that in principle, this being tied to a percent? Starting to feel like I'm negotiating the Middle East peace process here.
I think
was once talk about, maybe there should be a mediation role rather than a...
Obviously, it's not our preference, but I think that we would obviously be more content with 25% than the 50% that was being...
Yes, but...
And without the timescale, if you...
If there's no timescale, yeah, would you...
Then we would think it would have to be quite a low percentage. And, you know, as part and parcel of this... negotiation that we've been having. I mean, we have, in our minds, we have compromised considerably in the sense that the park and ride facility previously was on 2 hectares of land. It now will be around about 1 hectare of land. The density has risen from 30% to 35%, which over a 20-hectare site is quite a considerable enhancement in the value.
Okay,
and
so
the B2 and B8 should also help.
So you'd be happy with the percent, but are you sticking at 25, or is there any flexibility on that figure?
I'll meet you halfway.
I think we would prefer to stick with 25%. So.
Okay, so that's 25.
You're I'll meet them halfway between 25 and 50.
You want to move to 30? It's all judgment-based, isn't it?
30.
Right. Okay, look, in the interest of bringing this to an end, I'm going to suggest 30%.
Yes, okay, thank you.
Go out and buy a used car. Yes. Practice. Okay. I once had a used car dealer telling me I was there was the hardest person they'd ever had to sell a car. Didn't believe them. I think they were just saying that. The other aspect of this that's in red is that the park and ride facility may include shared use provision and single story decking. I wasn't quite sure what shared use provision might mean. How can you share the use of a park and ride facility?
I think that was an allusion to the amount of parking that might be associated with, you know, for example, the hotel. I think potentially thought there could be some synergy there. The decking relates to, even though the...
Well, hang on, we'll come on to the decking in a moment, because I can understand that more clearly. Do you understand what shared use would mean?
No, I mean, we assume, sir, that it was that other uses would use it, which to us seemed counterintuitive. If this is to be a commercial park and ride where spaces are going to be at a premium, if you're giving them over to other uses, it certainly calls into question whether you need 450.
We would concede that point.
Okay, yeah, I would take it out because I think it just clouds issues. Then the second part is the use of single storing decking to maximise site efficiency. So is that saying that essentially you've got... You're creating a small multi-storey car park, aren't you, really? Is that what you're suggesting?
A very low multi-storey car park.
A low multi-storey, yeah. Two-storey
but,
car
but
park.
The benefit to Henry Boot might be that it reduces the... site requirement.
So I've been kind to you, but you disagree.
Well, I'm always deeply suspicious when the councillor comes.
No, but why would you, you know, I suppose the council's saying that, that, you know, that's a measure that could reduce the land take.
Yeah. I mean, I think in terms of reducing the land take, that would be welcomed. I think it's obviously just for clarification. Henry Boot are only, as part of this, providing the land. There was an iteration where we would be providing land and the facilities themselves. So that doesn't... It helps on the land take, but there's no obligation on Henry Boot to actually provide those facilities. We're just providing the land, just so that's clear.
I think the context of this, sir, is actually to do with the discussion that took place... in the second stage hearing on the 29th, where I think you asked a question of Mr. Black, who's at that, in relation to what would we do if we found that we needed, that we'd reduce the area of the car park to 1 hectare, but we actually, the park and ride was a lot more successful. And I think the comment was made that we could potentially put a second deck on. I think that's the context that this was raised in.
Okay. Sounds like a good question. I'm not entirely sure I can remember asking it, but anyway. So, where does that leave us? Are there any visual concerns about having single-storey decking? I'm trying to think of examples where I've seen that. Bristol Temple Meads, I think, as I roll past it on the train.
A lot of station car parks, they seem to do that. And they've also done it at the Luton Dunstable Hospital as well. I think
how's that going to work with your visual concept for a technology park?
Where the current site is, or plot is, in relation to the boundary, there's an existing substantial kind of tree and hedgerow line that would screen that particular aspect of the site.
Okay, and are Henry Boot correct when they say, which is how I would read it, there is the intention is they provide the site, not the facility itself. So that phrase there isn't intended to include that. Okay.
The only other point, sir, and I don't know whether this helps or hinders, it obviously, the wording there saying decking to maximise the efficiency. That's the suggestion, if I'd understood correctly, was that it could provide the ability for additional spaces over the 450. Maximising efficiency, I thought, was making the best use of the site, not increasing the number of car parking. Just an observation.
Well, I suppose reading the policy overall, it says plot of land sufficient for 450 spaces. I suppose I read the text in red as saying that, therefore, if you introduce single-storey decking to accommodate 450 spaces, that would lead to a lesser land take. Yeah. Is that what was intended?
I think that's the context in which we were suggesting it. You know, so if Henry Boot were very successful in attracting development onto the site, then it's one way in which the land take aspect could be reduced. I mean, if it's not helpful, probably the logical thing to do would be to take it out.
As you said, it doesn't actually affect ourselves in terms of...
it could do, couldn't it?
Well, sorry, in terms of what we're required to deliver, I think, obviously, we'd welcome something that just does ensure that the less land take, the better.
So you'd support it?
Yeah.
OK, so leave it in there. Then finally, I think subject to its provision, additional Section 106 contributions towards off-site transport infrastructure funding of the facility will not be sought. So, is the wording "the facility"? What does that relate? Does that relate to the park and ride? So from within Butterfield, why is that disputed? Is that the intention is that you won't seek any further contributions?
From within Butterfield.
From development within Butterfield, yeah.
We might want to from elsewhere, such as sites where car parking is lost.
Yeah, so you might require it from someone else.
Yes.
So it's just for clarity.
We're comfortable with that.
Yeah. Okay, right. Yeah. Okay, so I'd leave that in. I suppose even if it wasn't there, I think the context would make it clear it would only be relating to Butterfield. I think it would be hard to argue anything else, maybe. Okay. Good. Are you likely to need any consequential changes to supporting text as a result of any of these changes? There isn't actually much supporting text, is there?
Subject to the council, I was just jotting down earlier. I think there are some, just sort of parts of clarification. I think to LP13... And sort of various paragraphs 5.5 and 5.9. Just a quick look, because it doesn't necessarily refer to the to the B8 uses, and Butterfield being an appropriate location for those uses.
I think, as a general point, sir, that we've we've obviously just discussed quite a number of possible proposed modifications throughout the hearings.
Yeah.
And the need for us to check for consequential changes is something that we're going to have to do as a matter of course, I think, as part of the next stage, as it were.
Yes, okay. Yes, so that's something we're going to need to do for a number of the changes, isn't
elsewhere
it?
Elsewhere as well.
Yeah. Again, it's always difficult, but I would try and put those consequential changes all together if you can. But I suppose it depends on whether there are. I suppose it's just think carefully about how you can minimise the number of main modifications by putting them together. It might not always work.
Yeah. I think the way that we've started to do it is to do them sequentially as they're listed in the plan, just because that's the easiest way of doing it. I think it's once we've completed the list,
yeah.
It then becomes much easier to say, well, we can start to combine some of these. Yeah.
Yes, I suppose if you've got a stray consequential change relating to one of those sequential ones, it's easier to drop it in, isn't it? The problem will come if you've got a change in your sequential order to a policy that's got a consequential change from somewhere else.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
That's right.
Okay. Is there anything else anyone wants to say about Butterfield?
No, sir. I suppose my comment is going forward in terms of, so this policy in effect will be a main modification published as such. Is there a time frame for when that's likely to...
Well, that's a good question. I was going to ask the council that tomorrow will be the final day, so I was going to ask the council then for its timescales. I suppose what it doesn't know from me yet is what I'm going to ask it to do, if anything, about Power Court and Stockwood. But if you were to look at worst case for that in terms of work, are you able to... I will ask you again tomorrow, but presumably you've thought about it.
Broadly speaking, I had a discussion with the programme officer sort of to try and sort of take some of her experience elsewhere. And the draft programme that I'd put together, I think if I remember rightly, it sort of probably would take about 16 or 17 weeks to get through the process of putting the modifications together, ensuring that you're happy with them, then going out to SA on them, and then preparing them for publication, 6 weeks consultation, and then summarising the outcome of that. I thought that it was probably around 16 or 17 weeks. And we can break that down with you today, tomorrow,
and
see whether you think that's reasonable or it can be.
I suppose that might, depends on your, to some extent, your internal processes. I think the first part is to arrive as quickly as possible as a draft, and as you'll have, I don't know if you've been here when I've discussed main modifications before, but the standard process inspectors will follow is, if the principle of main modifications has been established by an inspector, what the inspector will do is want to see the draft that the council produces before it goes out to formal consultation. So there is a bit of a process through the programme officer with the inspector.
I mean, the initial stages, I think I said when we were in the last sessions before Christmas, was that we would hope to turn around and get the sort of first draft main modifications to you within a couple of weeks, or say with 2 weeks after the end of this week.
Yeah.
And then it's a question of how long there might be any sort of to and froing as a result of...
Yeah, well, I think that's a good aim, is to get them done quickly, because, of course, you've not done the ones from stage two yet, have you? No, from the ones... You've done stage two, haven't you? You've not done the ones from before Christmas.
Most of those have been done
and
just need putting together now. There's some work to be done.
Another reason for doing that is, by and large, through January and February... I suppose the other way it works is that inspectors will, at this stage, while the council's going through the main modifications process, inspectors generally have some time to start writing up but beware, because what happens is the planning inspectorate says, well, you can defer your writing up, can't you, because we've got another plan we'd like you to do. Now, at the moment, I haven't, so the faster you get on with it, the better in terms of my response. I'm doing one other plan at the moment, but, you know, two's manageable. So, yeah, I'd get on with it quickly.
Yeah, I mean, we've been in touch with our SA consultants, and we sort of estimate that they may need something like 3 weeks or thereabouts to turn that round. So we've asked them to sort of anticipate that in February.
Yeah, I mean, I would push on as fast as you can now, really, because my experience is the more the delay goes on, the more things happen in between. You've already heard that Central Bedfordshire are pausing because of the white paper. You know, that's just an example of things that can happen. And I've had examinations where councils have spent several months deliberating over the wording of the main modifications, only to find that all sorts of things happen in the meantime that then have to be dealt with in some way. So, yes, there is a process to go through. Council does the main modifications, does SA. I'll need to see the SA as well.
Yeah.
My understanding is I remain jointly responsible for it through the examination.
Yeah.
So, I mean, and the council advertises them.
I've assumed that once the material comes back from the consultant on the SA, that it would need to go to you.
Yeah.
And therefore, and then once we get the stuff back from you, we're going to have to prepare that publication in a suitable form for publication.
Yes, and then
which will probably take a couple of weeks.
Yeah, okay. And consultation would follow the form of Regulation 19, so we're looking at a six-week process. Then, as you say, what comes in needs to come to me.
Yeah.
Then I need to decide what to do with it. Does that help?
It does. So my final question was, are you expecting or envisaging us liaising with the council in terms of when we're talking about sort of defining the technology park, what that sort of concept is, and the suggested sort of wordings that you've made to the...
Well, I think we got close to wording, didn't we, today? I think I will leave it between you whether you want to do...
Yeah.
I mean, I think I generally say this to councils. If you want to do informal consultation or dialogue with parties about your drafting, then in a way that's your choice. I know you've been doing it so far, so I'll perhaps leave that for you to...
We'd be happy to share that with you.
Right, anything else for today?
No, thank you.
Okay, good. Finished before 5 o'clock. Fantastic. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. You want your only drawing back?
If I may, sir, we can send you a clean version.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you.